Hello all, welcome to eShikshana program. This lecture is about site climate, also called as microclimate. Now in this lecture, we are going to study about what is macroclimate, what is microclimate, what are the effects of landscape elements on this site climate, or it is also called as microclimate, and what is urban heat island effect. We'll also try to understand what is greenhouse effect and what is the similar kind of you can say urban heat island effect that usually any urban area executes. So we can understand microclimate based on the scale of that particular region. Okay, now there is a small change we can say in climate of a particular place. If you are considering the climate of an overall region, then it is called as macroclimate. So macroclimate basically is the climate of an overall region. For a larger area, like for cities, we can consider macroclimate. And mesoclimate can be considered as intermediate between macroclimate and microclimate. Okay, so microclimate is usually the climate that we architects consider for designing of buildings. So we try to consider what is the special, or you can say the differences between the overall region and that particular for a particular, or you can say a smaller region. The climate usually is different from a bigger region to a smaller region because of various other factors. We'll study all the factors in detail. Okay, so by definition we can say that macroclimate is for a larger region, for a larger extent, or for a larger geographical area, but whereas microclimate can be for a very smaller region that we usually consider for designing of buildings. And mesoclimate is, you can say, intermediate, so it can be in between. It is the area that is in between macro and micro. We can consider that as mesoclimate. Now every city, town or village, and even a precinct in a town may have its own climate, slightly different from the climate that is described for that particular region. Now suppose we can consider the hot dry region or temperate region or moderate regions. So as we studied in the climatic classifications, so there are different regions that we have classified. So in within that region, again there might be some small changes, or they can say some difference within the climatical aspects. Okay, so it might be slightly cooler than the overall region, it might be slightly hotter, or it might be experiencing high humidity levels or low humidity levels than when compared to that larger area or larger region. Okay, so some of the examples you can say the Mount Abu, that is very colder region, but it is located in, you can say, Rajasthan. Okay, now Rajasthan is a very hot dry climate, but Mount Abu is a colder region. Mount Abu experiences that particular climate because of the elevation. It is elevated, so because of the elevation it experiences the cold weather. Okay, so there is a change in that particular region when compared to the surrounding region. Okay, so that is the difference of a, you can say, microclimate. Now macroclimate can be usually considered as the climate for a particular region, maybe particular town, city, or you can say a smaller precinct also. Okay, so that is considered as macroclimate. Now coming to the definition of microclimate, so we can't basically define the region on which we can say, so this region or this area, we can't give any area like per se. We can't consider 40 kilometers or 40 square kilometers or 40 square meters or 40 square feet as to be decided as microclimate, because for a botanist, he might consider the microclimate as the area that is around a leaf. Okay, but because leaf executes let's say transpiration, and it experiences shade, or it is located in at a certain height and this thing, so that leaf, the area around the leaf experiences certain different climate, so that can be a microclimate for a botanist. But if you consider an urban geographer, for him the there might be certain pockets like around the lake, within the like market city, or where there are buildings which are higher buildings, the area which is slightly paved on this thing. So there might be different pockets for that particular microclimate. So it depends on the magnitude, or you can say the scale of the project, or what kind of area is perceived. Okay, so that can be defined as microclimate. Basically, you can consider microclimate is a climate for a smaller region, and that can be considered for designing of, you can say, buildings, or for design for the architecture. Okay, so so sometimes what happens, so there might be a different kind of architecture that has been practiced, or that is evolved in a particular very smaller region or in a particular site. So that might be because of the microclimatic influences, the changes in the climatic you can say characteristics of that particular or a smaller region will experience a difference. So that is why there is a change in, you can say, climatic characteristics. So that is called as microclimate. So this microclimate is almost same, you can say the factors are almost same as of climatic characteristics what we studied. Precipitation, that is nothing but rainfall. Solar energy, the type of solar energy that is been experiencing, that is been influencing for a particular you can say side of the site. Okay, we'll try to understand that in detail. So basically the solar energy and temperature, the carbon dioxide or the various gases that have been in the atmospheric condition, and vegetation, and also the wind movement. Okay, the kind of wind movement or the behavior of wind in that particular region is defining a particular microclimate. So these factors are, these you can say are the major microclimatic factors. Now, if you try to understand the local factors, it is again defined by topography of that particular area. Okay, so topography defines the slope and the orientation of that particular slope to a particular direction. Okay, now let's consider a microclimate of a hill. So we are saying microclimate as shown in the figure. You can see in this image. So microclimate of this particular hill. Okay, so there is one side, or you can say half, is exposed to sunlight, so that you can consider southern side, which is experiencing sunlight for a major part of the day, and a shaded or sloped that you can consider for, you can consider this as a north side. Okay, now because of the exposure of this particular side to the sunlight for the major part of the day, there is a difference in temperature because it is getting heated up, the earth is getting heated up. And because of the sunlight, there is a difference in vegetation also. There might be more vegetation because more plants sustain, and there might be a change in the humidity levels also. So we can see that because of the topography of a particular land, there is change in the climate of this particular region to the, you can say, the shaded slope. Okay, so that might not experiencing any sunlight, because of which there might be less vegetation, and it might be colder. Okay, so this is again because of the heating or because of the cooling, it might be experiencing different type of wind movement also. So that wind movement can be very much understood by the behavior of wind in valley, as you can see in the right image. So there is a different kind of flow during day and during night. Okay, so during day the air tends to move in a along the valley, and during night the warm air rises up in between the valley. So that is creating again you can say the wind flow, or you can say the direction of the wind flow is different during day and different during night. So this is again a change in the particular, you can say, microclimate. Okay, and this behavior can be experienced in different valleys, and it also depends on the particular height of the valley and the width of the valley. Okay, so that is again very much subjective to that particular place, what kind of topography or what kind of land mass is present in that particular area, and also what is the climatic conditions, and what is the, you can say, vegetation. Okay, so and if there are any water bodies, or what kind of humidity levels are there. So all of these factors will influence the, we can say the local factors of that particular valley will influence this particular, you can say, climatic factors. So this is nothing but microclimate of a particular hill. So the microclimate on this side is different from this side. The microclimate of a valley, which is, I can say, the higher region towards the lower region is different, because it is experiencing again different kind of wind movement and different kind of, again, we can also say the sunlight that is falling on that particular region. Okay. So similarly, this is, I think, the most of the Western Ghats experiences this. So that is, if you consider the currents from the Indian Ocean that is carrying a lot of moisture, and because of the hills, that is the Western Ghats, because of the Western Ghats, there is heavy rainfall in that particular area. Okay, so that is second windward and leeward side. Okay, so immediately after Western Ghats, there is again plains which experiences, you can say, the dry lands. Okay, and most of the rains, the cloud loses its, you can say, the precipitation happens mainly during in the Western Ghats, and having very good vegetation and very good, because of the lot of rainfall, there is very good vegetation that is happening. And as it crosses the Western Ghats, you can see that the plains, you can say plains of Karnataka or Tamil Nadu, which will not experience that much rain as of Western Ghats. So this is a very good example for this particular, you can say, climatic behavior. Okay. So in that particular hill also, we can see that which is towards the windward will experience a lot of wind. It will experience a lot of rainfall also, but whereas the leeward side, which might not experience that much of rainfall, so it is having less vegetation and it is comparatively dry compared to the windward or towards the, you can say, Western Ghats. Okay, so this is again a small climatic change, or you can say behavior, because of the local factors. Okay, so again, it might be topography, it is also the location, or it is also the elevation that is, if your project, your site is. If your site is on the top of this hill, so then it is partially experiencing, you can say, this monsoon, heavy monsoons, and partially experiencing this thing. But if it is more towards the ocean or this thing, so then it is experiencing very heavy winds. That I think every monsoon, during every monsoon, this region experiences a lot of heavy winds and a lot of rainfall. If your site is located on towards a drive or leeward or towards a slope, towards a, you can say, descending slope, so then it experiences a very dry climate or dry weather. Okay, even though if it is in the very close vicinity, or you can say close region, so it may not be as I told, Western Ghats, like if you consider the slope and these things, it is very far. But if you consider it for a very smaller area also, there might be, it might be experiencing these kind of small climatic changes or small changes in the microclimate. Okay, so that is, here we can say, because of the topography and wind direction and because of vegetation, so there is change in the microclimate. Okay. So ground surface actually also plays a very important role in, you can say, microclimate. The ground surface, it can be natural or it can be man-made. Now, natural surfaces can be again with earth exposed, or it can also have, let's say, vegetation. So vegetation, it can be grass, it can be trees. So these different ground covers have different behavior. glossed or finished surfaces, let's say concrete surfaces or paved areas, absorb a lot of heat. And sometimes they reflect a lot of light also. But whereas compared to when we take, let's say, vegetation, that is grassland, or if we take earth, so that will not absorb, or it will not hold a lot of heat. And it will not reflect a lot of light also. So because of that, again, there is a change in the particular microclimate. If you consider this image where we can see that there is light that is getting reflected and it is entering into the building. Okay, and so this is reflecting of, you can say, natural light. It is different for different surfaces, and different surfaces also exhibit different kinds of heat gain. Okay, as I told earlier, the paved areas, or you can say the rock or hard strata, which can be, you can say, man-made, we generally use for parkings or these kind of areas, will absorb a lot of heat. They absorb a lot of heat and they'll radiate a lot of heat. But whereas if it is a green cover, like a grass cover, or you can say the earth, which will not absorb heat, and eventually it will not radiate heat also. So that is again comparatively cooler compared to the paved areas or concrete paved areas. It can be clay or any other material which is having higher density will absorb a lot of heat. Okay. So that is how these kind of, you can say, ground surfaces will also influence the microclimate. Okay. So if there is more paved area, then you experience more heat. If it is less, then you experience less heat. Okay. So that is, you can say, another local factor. The buildings that are there in the city also play a major role. So there might be certain buildings which is having glass, which will reflect a lot of light from one building. Or even if it is painted white, if it is very light in color, if it is these things, fluorescent or this thing, so they also reflect a lot of light from one building to adjacent building if it is very close to each other. So then there is also some change in microclimate of that particular, you can say, one side to another side. Okay. Now this can experiences, the city can experience this kind of you can say a change in microclimate, not just because of sunlight, because of maybe the air movement. They might be creating, buildings might be creating air shadows, the wind shadows, sorry, we call it as wind shadows. So it also might experience the shadow, that is tall buildings in front of smaller buildings. So they also experience, you can say, the shadow, that is in the form of the light is getting obstructed because of the height of the buildings. So they might also experience wind shadow. And it also might radiate a lot of heat from one building to another building because of the material properties and these things. So there is again a change in the, you can say, microclimate of that particular region. Okay. So there might be a lot of trees that are planted on a building. So that is again, it might be increasing humidity levels, or there might be a small change in that particular building because of the trees, because of the vegetation, or because of maybe the surface, the kind of surface it is treated. If it is a reflective surface, it will reflect a lot of light, and also it will reflect a lot of heat along with the light. Okay. So other building, which is supposed to, you can see the first, these things where it is marked one. So if you're considering this as south and the north facade, the considering north, let us say this architect has designed a lot of openings on from this side, let's say north side. And because it is this other building, which is taller than this, is having, let's say, glazed surface, is reflecting the south light to the north facade of this building. Okay. So then this building might experience, let's say, even though you are providing north openings, so then you might be getting a lot of south, the harsh light that is reflected from other building. Okay. So there might be a difference in the initial you have designed for considering for a larger region, but when you try to consider the climate of this particular site, we can say that there is a lot of light that is coming from this side also. So that is why we need to understand the behavior of building or behavior of climatic characteristics in that particular site. Okay. So if it is having a wide road, again it might absorb a lot of heat. If it is adjacent to park, so then again it might, the small climate might be different. Okay. So similarly, if you can see, let's consider, if you consider Bangalore, so there is a difference of, you can say, microclimate when you go to, let's say, Alsur Lake, or if you go to Lal Bagh, or if you go to Electronic City, or towards HL, or if you come towards, let's say, more crowded and taller buildings, or the Central Business District or Majestic area. So there is a very small difference in the climate of these particular regions. So that is nothing but, again, you can say, microclimate. Okay. So this microclimate should be studied in regards with the similar what we studied for climatic characteristics, that is air temperature, okay, you can say precipitation, the wind direction and the humidity. Okay, so we need to study basically in these factors so that we can understand how to design buildings. Okay, so many times what happens is considering the, let's say if you are designing buildings considering the larger area, or you can say if you are designing considering macro climate, that is climate of a larger area, so then your building might experience some kind of problems because of these small microclimatic changes. So then they try to do certain retrofittings, that is they try to provide extra overhang, or they try to have different arrangement on the facade, or they might have to change the facade, remove the glass, put blocks, or remove the these things, curtain walls, and then put some other. So there might be some kind of retrofittings, or there might be some changes that is required later on. So it is better to consider these microclimatic, or you can say local factors, before execution or before designing of buildings. Okay, so it is not just enough for an architect to understand the climate of that particular region, but also for a smaller region, for the smaller site that he has been designing. Okay, now air temperature inversion. So the temperature, you can see, is different for during at different we can say height, and also for the daytime and nighttime. Okay, so this is again different for the different elevations. We can see as we go up or the height is increasing, the air temperature is decreasing. Okay, so as we go the ground exhibits, I think you can see the larger variations, that is during day, during maximum temperature would be around, let's say 35 degrees, but that is very close to the ground, and minimum temperature would be less than or it would be close to 15 degrees Celsius. Okay, so for any region. So then when we see for a very lower altitude, or for a, let's say higher altitude, that is around let's say 300 mm, so then you can see the difference. Even for the daytime, the maximum temperature or the highest temperature is around 22 to 23 degrees Celsius, or around 23 degrees Celsius, and it is same at night also, but there is a eventual, you can say, dip in during night time. And so this inversion happens because of the humidity levels. Okay, so because of the humidity, change in humidity levels at a lower region and higher region, there is it executes this kind of behavior. So that is air temperature, or you can say temperature inversion at different heights. So based on the if you are designing for the higher altitudes or for a different heights, then we need to consider this temperature inversion. Okay, now humidity during the lay during day, as the lowest layer of air is being heated by the ground surface, its high RH, or you can say relative humidity, is rapidly decreased. With the lower humidity, the rate of evaporation is increased. If there is water available to be evaporated, an open surface of water of rich vegetation would provide abundant supply of water. In such case, strong evaporation would increase the absolute humidity of lower layers of air. So this is what we studied as temperature inversion. We can see that temperature at ground, if it is high, and if it is low at in the first case what we studied let's say 2 meters, it is very low. Then relative humidity as compared to temperature, we can say, is inversely proportional. The relative humidity is kind of inversely proportional for the temperature, and absolute humidity is very much similar to the temperature. If there is high temperature, it executes high temperature, high absolute humidity at ground level, and low humidity at, we can say, at higher level. Okay, so this is the relation between, you can say, humidity and air temperature. Okay, so that is again given by psychrometry. We'll be studying psychrometry in detail. Okay, so precipitation, so that is precipitation of different areas is different, that is because of maybe again topography or because of the buildings that execute. So because of the, we can say, because of the hills or these things, so there is lot of rainfall towards the windward side, or because of maybe the buildings, there might be a lot of, it might be experiencing a lot of rains. So we see lot of lot of cities have will be getting a lot of rain because of this particular behavior. Okay, so we need to understand if you are designing for the buildings for a particular level of, you can say, or you can say a particular level of rainfall, so then we need to understand what is a particular site climate. So sky conditions, again, sky conditions might be differing based on the wind and rain. So the windward side, it might be getting less radiation because it is, the clouds are carrying a lot of water, or it is very thick clouds. And the leeward side, after the rainfall, this thing, so it is experiencing more sunlight because of the sky condition, the sky, it is having less sky cover, or sky cover which might be around, let's say, it might be having a clear sky, which is about, the cloud cover might be around 12%. So then it is experiencing a lot of sunlight. So that is again changing the particular site climate or microclimate. The solar radiation is again very similar to what is experienced by the sky condition. Okay. Now air movement, again, it differs for a urban center, or you can say the open sea or county. So here it experiences lot of masses, different masses, because of which the wind gradient is, you can see, more. But whereas for the open sea country, it is very less, or with very lower altitude, the air movement, the wind gradient is raising 100%. Okay. So there might be some special characteristics of our particular region, like thunderstorms, dust storms, earthquakes. For thunderstorms, usually they have in a particular direction of the flow of wind, and also the what they carry. So so they are experiencing, if there are buildings, or again if there are any physical barriers, so buildings on the windward side might experience a lot of thunderstorms, whereas leeward side it might be experiencing negative pressures. So they might be, the windward side might be experiencing you can say positive pressure. Similarly, dust storms or other things, so based on the that particular location of the site, it experiences different dust storms. Okay. Similarly, some special regions might be experiencing more earthquake if it is very close to tectonic plates, or based on the geographical location, we can say it experiences these special characteristics. Okay. Vegetation, as vegetation also plays a very major important role in controlling the microclimatic condition. We try to change the microclimatic conditions. If there is very hot and dry weather, we try to use a lot of, you can say, trees. We try to use a lot of plantations or vegetation to increase the humidity levels, which eventually will help in evaporative cooling. Okay. Now these vegetation, that is plants or trees or shrubs, they execute photosynthesis, and during photosynthesis also they give out a lot of oxygen and also moisture, or they evaporate a lot of moisture into the air. So that is how they also cool the particular environment of a smaller region. So, and vegetation can also be used to channelize the wind movement. Okay. So it can be used to create venturi effect, as seen in this thing. So it is increasing the wind velocity. so there is again a difference in the percentage of vegetation. If you are using more vegetation, then again there is more humidity, and it is trying to change the, or you can say we are trying to make the microclimate more comfortable by use of vegetation. Okay. So we can also control the air if it is very there is lot of or heavy winds. So then we try to increase or we try to divert the wind, or also we want to protect our buildings experiencing this wind. So we can have lot of plantations to break the wind. Okay. So there are again different types of winds that will control the humidity levels, or you can say, if there are a lot of dust particles in that particular wind, by vegetation we can control that particular sand storms or dust storms, so that we are not getting affected because of those particular the sand storms. Okay. So we can so convection, because of convection there is again lot of heat that is lost or captured in the in these trees and giving a cold air, okay, which is again which might be again heated up or you see. So because of vegetation we can actually control lot of the characteristics of you can say wind or temperature or humidity also. Okay, now coming to the urban climate, where there are a lot of buildings or the density of people is more and there are very buildings of are very close vicinity. So because of these man-made environments can create microclimates of their own. So this as I told earlier, so there might be difference in the microclimate of a central business district to a you can say the periphery of a city. Okay, so that is because of the maybe ground surface treatment, because of the how the water bodies are treated, because of the building masses that is increasing the heat gain. So these you can say that is because of the surface qualities, because of the buildings casting shadows, because of energy that has been reflected and it has been captured by different materials that is used for, let's say, concrete captures lot of, or it is harvesting lot of heat energy and it radiates a lot of heat energy at night. And maybe because of the atmospheric pollution also, maybe because of the activities that has been performing in a particular region. Okay, so because of all these activities there might be an increased heat in that particular or for a smaller region. Okay, so that is nothing but again defined by urban climate. Now there is very interesting phenomena which is also called as urban heat island effect. Now because there is lot of activities or there is lot of waste that is being generated in let's say downtown or central business districts or an urban area, and because of lot of vehicles, so there is lot of greenhouses gases that are being left in the atmosphere. Okay, so because of this air pollution you can say the greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide or nitrous oxide, so all these greenhouse gases, so they the concentration of greenhouse gases is more in this particular environment or you can say atmosphere of a urban climate. So then it forms a cloud because it can't escape, because of these gases can't escape, so they form a cloud around this downtown or you can say central business district. Okay, so they are accumulated, all these greenhouse gases are accumulated in the we can say the downtown or the city center or central business district. Now what happens, sunlight when falls on these particular area for a downtown or a particular city, it can pass through this greenhouse gases, the incident sunlight can pass through the greenhouse gases because it contains UV rays. But whereas during night time when it is supposed to cool down, when the city is supposed to cool down, it radiates infrared radiations back into the atmosphere. Now these infrared radiations cannot pass through this greenhouse gases that are in the atmosphere, and because of which heat is trapped inside the bubble. Okay, so we can see a bubble is created here where there is a lot of you can say developments or urban settlement. Okay, so it creates a bubble in a urban settlement and this acts as a greenhouse. In greenhouse what happens, there is a lot of heat that has been accumulated, we are harvesting lot of heat that is from the sunlight, and it is not getting back into the atmosphere, we are trapping heat. Okay, so that we can grow plants and various other reasons. Okay, so that is nothing but greenhouse. So similar effect is created here because of the greenhouse gases that are present in the atmosphere, of higher concentration of greenhouse gases that are present in an urban settlement. So this effect is called as urban heat island effect. Okay, so it usually many cities experience this kind of urban heat island effect, especially we see that Delhi is currently experiencing. Every year there has been lot of problems in regards with the air quality, and also lot of smog that has been developed because of because of smog also, the greenhouse gases are not able to escape back into the atmosphere, which is also trapping a lot of, again, increasing the levels of pollutions, or it is trying to worsen the air qualities. And during summers also, what happens, because of these higher concentration of pollutants or greenhouse gases, the temperature of the overall city is increased as compared to that particular region. Okay, so generally we can say that urban settlements or urban areas experience more heat as compared to rural or suburban areas. That is because of mainly heat island effect. Okay, so that is why when we try to consider or design for a particular site in an urban area, we need to consider, or we need to measure, or we need to collect the particular site climatic data, or we can say microclimatic data, to avoid problems that might happen in future. Okay, so when we are designing for a downtown or a, let's say, commercial or a rural area, we need to measure, or we need to collect the information of climate of that particular area. Okay, so so this is very important for any architect before designing. So that was all about the site climate, or we can say microclimatic characteristics or microclimatic factors. Thank you.